However, now into champion select, and immediately Rengar taken off the board and away from Yankos.
Oh, Yankos looked really strong on the Hecarim yesterday. Yeah. Actually making the ganks. He wasn't going for the power farming that you can with the new Krugs and the Raptors. So, interesting to see that as the first ban. And wow, jungle focus here.
All right. I mean, I guess they kind of agree with what we just talked about. Yankos being one of the guys we're looking at to kind of carry Europe through the early game here and get the big advantage. Rengar ban, I think it's just a respect for Rengar, because Yankos never been like a massive Rengar player. Lee Sin, of course, is his signature pick.
Well, interesting as well, we have jungle being banned out on the side of Team Fire, but Team Ice is all about shutting down the mid lane here. So you can see where the team's priority is already pretty early in the big ban phase.
You don't normally talk about trends in your what is an invitational event like All-Stars, but Team Fire have been really prioritizing Nautilus. Nautilus first pick, Nautilus flex pick. The Rek'Sai is also another interesting one, because Fengi's champion pool has never been massive, and Rek'Sai specifically has been a really big contested pick. But the Nautilus up, Nautilus flex pick once again.
Exactly, yeah. Flex picking, Madlife likes to play these tank supports now. And I don't think Faker really minds these three bans against him. We know he can just play Victor if he wants to be super boring.
And you call him a tank support. Remember, he's also a hook support. Madlife is known for the Madlife.
So what about the Town Kench yesterday? Lick support?
I got nothing for that. Move on.
Okay.
Look, Deficio, it's not about what happened yesterday. Focus on the here and now.
Yes.
3 years ago when he played a lot of fresh. But, you know, maybe it could be hooks versus hooks in the bottom lane. I know we're not supposed to talk about hoverovers, but please someone play Blitzcrank.
I think we're going to see a fairly serious pick and ban phase. Again, we might get the Blitzcrank in one for all mode. We saw that last year at least. This first rotation, we've seen a lot of Rek'Sai come in, especially when Lee Sin is being banned. We know Yankos likes to play it as well. Unless he wants to really carry. And that's the thing. The European players yesterday just said, you know what? Not, you know, boring tanks top, no tank junglers, no, let's play carries everywhere, and they're doing the same again.
And look, they're actually thinking about junglers. What will they land on?
Yankos, smile on his face. I think it is going to be the Elise as well as the Kennen locked in. Deficio just said it carries a lot of damage potential already early on.
And it's definitely a takeaway pick from Bengi, one of his comforts. Bengi has talked about this tournament as kind of like a job interview for him. He's another one of these players like Madlife looking for his next place. Will he show us a Bengi pick, or will he be like, no, look, I'm still spry, I may have 3 world championships, but I can play the Hecarim, I can play something crazy. Knowing Bengi, it's going to be standard, but we can hope.
Let's get the famous Bengi in Italy, 100% win rate.
It's never been defeated. No, you've been doing your research.
I know.
I'd
copied your research. Okay, let's look at these win rates here. Oh, 100%. That's 100%. Impressive.
He's never lost.
No, never lost on that champion. Might just be something like Olaf's still a good matchup into Elise. Olaf is still good in this meta, alongside 10 other junglers, because the jungle is just really, really strong right now.
When was the last time you could say there was upwards of, let's say, 6 junglers in the meta? It feels like there's always been that pocket, you know, like the
Triforce,
the Triangle. It's crazy to think that there really is that many viable picks.
Well, Olaf, of course, being one of them alongside the Ezreal. They're teasing us again every time with those hoverovers, not the Kled. Ezreal now locked in for Prey, and, you know, a solid pick for him across the board.
But this is a Vayne game now from Reckless. You're against the Ezreal. It's an old, old matchup that was in favor of Vayne. Get past the first few levels and then, especially level 6. Oh, Illaoi!
Wait,
Kennenated character!
No. We talked to Reckless. He said he wanted to bust out the old picks. He said he wanted to
iconic
bust out something
picks.
Special.
I can't believe we joked about the cannon and said this was a time when Reckless didn't have to carry. He just played Kennen AD carry, and now he's actually doing it again.
The build path will be a really interesting track as Teemo's being considered, let's say.
Okay, don't play with my heart. All right, let's talk about what they do. We have Illaoi and Kennen on the same team. Is this just the dream combo setup?
I've never got to cast an Illaoi game, never played in Korea. What about the wildcard factor? Because there's literally never been a top-level professional game of Illaoi in Korea.
See, I actually had a point prepared about the Roman Empire and Chaos Style and everything, but I'll do that in-game because these picks here are surprising. You know, that's how you try and beat the organized, fantastic killing machine on the side of Korea here. Madlife might be the guy ruining the day for Europe and just picking something like Janna. Unless he wants to play Nautilus support and like really take these big team fights. But against Kennen, against Illaoi, if you play like full disengaged support, you kind of make them useless in the team fights.
And then we have the 1v1 matchup to talk to. So it looks like it's going to be the support Nautilus if there is a Jace to be taken to the top lane. A range versus melee matchup that can go pretty well for the Jace.
Oh,
but Galio's locked in though.
We saw it once before, the shield so powerful. Faker fearlessly diving turrets time and time again, and it looks like he will pick it up, so.
You were talking about the 1-0s. There is the 1-0 Galio. Played it in the Kesper Cup and looked strong on the pick. It is gimmicky, it is flash-driven, but if you get that right engaged, the wombo combo with the Nautilus will be impressive, and it is the Jace locked in last.
All right, gentlemen, we talked about it. We said bot lane needs to win out. We said jungle needs to win out if EU want to come out on top. Do you think they have the tools to do it at this point? Have
yes.
you picked a comp to do so?
Especially the bot lane can do really well early on against a tank support, as well who will get a tier. So I think the European bot lane is very, very strong here. Jungle matchup is fairly even. Yankos, of course, can gank a lot on the Elise. Top lane as well, Illaoi wins so many matchups. She's such a strong laner, but the problem is she often gets camped and then she becomes used to it.
And is Jace one of those matchups? Because Jace has been the oppressive top lane pick.
Illaoi should be able to beat that.
That's a bold call.
Wait a minute.
All right, we need two analysts here for sure. What you got, Deficio?
Garen mid lane. All right, screw everything about serious pick and ban phase here. Europe is
he's looking for a counter pick.
Don't you take this away from the Deficio. They are here to win.
Oh, yeah.
And more importantly, they're going to spin to do it.
Consider the counter, Papasmithy here. Analyst to another analyst. Garen has a silence.
Yes.
Galio can get silenced. Interrupting duel.
So the big story there is Udyr and Garen were the kind of the two picks way back when that were the automatic cancellation of the Galio ult. Because if you had the bear stance or the silence props, of course you go in for an auto attack when you're taunted and interrupt. So the interrupt is there. The tick damage won't be as useful because the W will heal through it. But you know what the other fun thing is? Faker in solo queue in Korea always bans Galio, Gangplank, Garen. Those are the three picks that are the first in the Korean alphabet at the top of champ select. And hell, we got two of them in the mid lane.
And this is smart scouting by Europe. Clearly Faker is afraid of the Garen.
It must be. There's no other word for it.
This is the counter to Faker. It is the Garen in the mid lane from xPeke. He's been sitting home thinking about this.
Look at that steely look on the face of xPeke. He knows exactly what he's doing.
Well, if you believe in the steely-eyed gaze of xPeke, you can tweet at LOL Esports, hashtag IceWin. But if you think Faker and the Galio pick are going to carry this one home, hashtag FireWin. That's what you want to put in there as we get ready for a game. And these picks are absolutely insane. I want to hold you to something analytical, but we haven't seen any of these champions in so long.
Analysis needs not apply. Hype is here to stay.
Yeah, I think the last time I saw Garen was in the LPL.
Yes, Amazing J.
Amazing J pulled it out, and that's it.
This is it, ladies and gentlemen. You can hear the roar of the crowd. LCK on the blue side representing Team Fire. EU on the red representing Team Ice. And a whole lot of creative picks coming out.
Well, Bengi's so excited. Ghosted out of the gates. He wants to get in position, ostensibly. Not quite as punishing as the flash from Peke yesterday.
No, ghosting is fine because it will be ready, you know, by the time you need
it. They got the gust as well. They really are looking for an early pick.
Fast.
Early invade.
Living up to his name. He's going to need to back out here. Nothing going to happen quite yet.
Oh, he placed the ward. Ghosting for the ward.
Hey, man, you got to do what you got to do.
Get excited. Every ward.
So if you are watching this game and you want to play Garen in solo queue, because it will happen, in this game, Pick is running Grasp of the Undying as his keystone. Would have liked something like a Thunderlord for a little bit extra damage in there, but he clearly values the extra sustain for the Garen.
Galio is running the Courage on the other side of things. Obviously, the ult is the hard CC that will proc the Courage.
But obviously, Faker is getting ready for the five-man ulti that procs it with five men around, and he gets this 50% shield, basically, that makes him unkillable.
Taunted is going to get hit up, but it feels like a risky pick with the Galio. Kennen can auto-attack to stun him out in the right circumstance. You also have so much CC to cancel this.
Knock up from Zyra, Cocoon from long range from Yangus, the Silence from a Garen. There is tools here from Team Fire to counter Faker, but not the rest of us.
I was going to say, consider this. It is Faker, so let's just assume that he is going to have some swift tricks up his sleeve. It was a full AP Galio in the xPeke Cup, if you're wondering, so don't worry, no tanks in the mid lane.
I mean, we have to be honest, though, with Galio, he's a very simple champion. Like,
sure.
It is limited, even though you are, like, a mechanical god. It is kind of limited on how much you can do on this champion, specifically, like, of outplays.
Oh, Faker with the backwards gust.
Looking each other in the eye, fearless. Waiting for someone to pull the trigger.
It's pretty alpha to just waste mana in front of your opponent.
I mean, it's a shout out also to God B from last year. So he doesn't need to hit Peke with it.
No stranger to being alpha. He wasted flash in the face of his opponent yesterday.
And he played Garen, guys.
He was standing in a brush. There was nowhere near his opponent. That was not alpha. League of Legends hard mode is when you flash in the face of
him. Oh, look at the damage, Faker. Heals through most of it, that unfortunate trade. But xPeke is still pushing in the mid lane.
Well, damage over time abilities really do suck against Galio. But the fact he's a physical damage dealer is a bonus.
Oh, Smev running out, will get cursed up here.
I mean, you say that, but it's worth noting, he is double AD solo lane. Exactly. Reckless does mostly physical damage. Will, of course, have some magical damage as well. So, not sure how big that'll be. Ooh, jungler's potentially meeting here.
Oh, he actually left before he got to see if Bengu's there, because he's aiming for the gank in the bottom lane. A lot of CC from Europe. He's sneaking in. Remember, these are the guys we highlighted. These were the ones we need to carry early on.
And MadLife feeling mighty cozy, but here comes Jankos. Keep your eyes on that cooling red buff up and available.
Look at MadLife.
Does get the first plus shield. He's going to back off. It's a lot of damage. Flash to safety. Goes up. Comes down. Jankos with the first blood. Red buff taken down, but now he's in trouble. Faker on the way in. It's going to be the ult. Not the ult, the teleport instead. Reckless now getting cut down as well. This is disastrous for Team Ice. Mithy trying to make the hero play, but Bengi is just too tanky. Flash takes him to safety, but the axe, will it find him? It's Pekka there to back him out.
He'll be escorted out, but it's a 2-for-1. They didn't respect the teleport from Faker. It's worth noting, the Faker can sometimes be very much second to the roams. Yesterday, Wayless was making the big roam plays.
We're not
gonna walk
yet.
Back into lane.
Sure. And caught up by Pekka. The ignite goes down. Faker's in trouble. He's gonna heal up a decent amount. True damage is there.
Oh!
Garen spinning to win. The ice mark comes out. Mickey's backing up as well. Bengi silenced. Locked up. There's decent damage. Red buffs on both sides.
He spins it. It's the double.
Garen's back, boys.
Are you kidding me? We're watching Pekka on Garen against the LCK All-Stars. And he's just picked up a double kill.
Hey, man. Spin to win. It's pretty simple, but it works pretty damn effectively. And this is what happens. He didn't have the teleport to be bot, but he had the ignite for kill pressure. And this looks like kill pressure to me.
Great timing, silence first, so the shield doesn't come up from Faker, and then he just spins around him with enough damage. And now Bengi, obviously, no flash to get away with the ghost from him. And Pekka gets the kill with style.
Looks
That's
even
the
more
best
beautiful.
Way to get a kill.
Looks even more beautiful in slow motion.
Take a chance, hashtag EU mids. Busting it out. Of course, is going to itemize the Phage early on. We'll make it easier to stick to that target. But meanwhile, checking in on the top side of the map. Soaz doing okay in the trades, but not doing so hot in the CS department.
You just see no Illaoi in Korea, at least on the professional level. It's not a massive pick in solo queue in any region. So very interesting how Smab navigates. Well, it is a lane bully in Jace, we have to be clear.
Yeah, and it is a pick we've seen, you know, in the West quite a bit. North America played a little bit. Europe has played it quite a lot. For like 2 weeks, basically. It was a thing for 2 weeks. And then everyone was like, oh, actually, never mind, if I get camped, it sucks, so I'm just not going to play it anymore. But we had players like Wizzy Chachi who loves to play it, and now Swords obviously picked it up.
Curious to see what Soaz will itemize. Of course, Chachi knows that early death dance, but got to keep our eyes on the mid lane, because Pekka, as long as he has that red buff, just keeps trading into Faker, but without team there to back him up or the ignite to burn him down, not doing a whole lot.
Yeah, now it is very difficult as a melee champion in the mid lane to, like, chase someone down and actually kill them early on. Pekka might have to start roaming and go to some of these side lanes. Mm. Europe's team here, when it comes to diving bot lane, is going to be insanely
oh,
strong.
Boy.
Elise, Garen, and that's like instant kills on an AD carry. Bengi's top lane, though.
Ghosted.
Fight on her hands. Soaz is level 6. He can look for the out.
Bengi's there low. High five.
He's just a tourist here in the top lane.
He saw the level 6 and he was like, nope, I know enough to know that does love them.
Raw power of Wow, of course, still terrifying. You can shut her down. Always has that turnaround potential. Prey picking up the honey fruit on the bottom side. MadLife making a sweet way back into the laning phase.
Yeah, I do wonder if Bengi knows exactly how much damage Illaoi can deal after level 6, or if he's just seen the highlights. You know, where she's 10-0 and she's able to 1v3.
The Reddit highlights.
Exactly, the big Reddit highlights. Because when you actually play against it, yes, her damage is crazy at level 6, but it's not one-shotting you
sure.
this early on in the game. Still, he might have spotted Jankos on a ward as well near the top half of the map and just decided to play it safe.
Also, the first time that Bengi and Smab, I guess, you know, the first tournament at least, they've played together on a team, so there's a bit of novelty there.
So much damage coming in, marked out as the villain.
You notice the difference, though, see? The big story is Soaz, though.
Despite Smab taking so much damage, Soaz healing so much as well, will be cursed. Goes forward, flashes, maybe wants a little bit more. Tentacle!
Solo kill!
And that's how you deal a lot of damage. You're 1v1 here, there's no jungler for Soaz, so this time he can just pop the ulti, and Smab took a lot of extra hits from the tentacles, and he goes down.
So as may have been knocked out of the 1v1 bracket, but still getting his opportunity to 1v1 on the top side. But Pekka, it's a similar story. There's three members there. I don't know if he wants this fight. Goes in, still alive, knocks down Demacia onto Bengi. MadLife Wave is next, and Ice is taking control.
So many curveballs, but they're all working at least early.
Chaos style, baby!
Well, that is your region, of course, but this worked also, it's worth noting, for LPL yesterday. Scaling is going to be a very interesting question, but may not be relevant if they can keep finding engages like this. It looks like a 1-for-3, 1v3, but Ice is coming right into the fight.
Just enough damage from both Zyra, Cannon, Elise, and then Pekka with the ulti. Now we talk about the bot lane dive.
TP being used.
Now this Faker's teleport.
He
can tax the bot lane now. There you go. Classic. Didn't actually get the castles though. He was nice enough to just allow Prey to last hit them.
Good guy, Faker. Many players cancel the GP. Faker stays for the farm. Slightly different strategy overall, but EU, about 1,000 gold. Mithy having to flash to safety though, respecting the engage potential. Things so far looking good. Looking bad for Faker though. Garen in the bush. This is the classic. Haven't seen it since season 3. And now Pekka running for his life, but Minty's here to back him up. Ult goes in. No silence on the Garen. They're going to take that one down. Pekka now running for his life. It's going to get hooked up. Pekka set to fall, and that's a shutdown onto Faker.
Fool me once, shame on me. Fool me twice, shame on you. The big story then, what we saw in the first trade was the silence got so much value. The W came on late, and Faker just got chunked out. This time, silence was prepped. Every time he face checks, needs to have that on his mind. And they want more. They've already got 2 kills. They're looking at Reckless. The minion wave's not where it needs to be, though. So they're going to back away, at least for now.
Bliss going forward, getting aggressive. Does have ultimate. Is he going to use it? Yes, comes out. Getting aggressive here, Prey. Trying to heal up the minion wave.
The minion wave's
hitting him as well. Reckless, can he get this flash forward? Is he going to be able to grab it?
Oh! Yeah, he got it!
1-for-1 in the end. But now, Fire moving onto the tower.
Well, Reckless knew more members of Team Fire were coming to the bottom lane, and there's no way out. Just had to try and take down Prey with him. Yank is in the top lane.
Acceleration gate.
Tags him with the slow.
They can't look for the dive. Does hit the CC. There go the tentacles. And now it's a party under the tower. Soaz, one final smack to take him down.
Yeah, now the Lowry is getting fed. So fed. Smet made that mistake before. Yes, the Lowry will not one-shot you at level 6, but if you stand in the tentacles, you will die. And he did. Pekka is chasing Madlife. The classic Garen Nautilus we often see.
Really, when we look at this matchup,
I mean, another round of spells ult will kill Madlife here.
Silence.
And Faker will be there. Doesn't have the ultimate. Nope, Duran not quite available yet. Mangy on the way in. No mana to spam the axes. Pekka have to play respect here. Ray on the backside. Pekka maybe set
the Garen
going in. Plan's going to slow a little bit. Out comes the ultimate for the disengage. Get frisky. A lot of low health bars.
And we've seen Pekka a few times now jump onto Faker after he got that kill. Only problem here for Garen is the animation when he's casting the Q to land that silence is sadly for Pekka slow enough that Faker often can just start shielding himself.
Yep.
And then the next, you know, spin to win thing doesn't really do that much. So whenever you see these trades, always look for like the Q first from Pekka and how fast Faker gets up the shield. If the shield is up, Pekka can't really get him low enough to actually kill him.
I had the pleasure of talking to Doublelift on the analyst desk yesterday during the game. I was talking about 80 carry builds. You see a BF sword in the item and my itemization for Cannon, and his idea was basically IE into Shiv, IE into Hurricane, you're ready to go.
Yeah.
Do you think we'll actually see Infinity Edge Cannon here?
Yep.
Just because the build right now is so powerful on zero sum?
Yeah, I definitely believe you will see just BF now, and then now you go for your Hurricane.
Hurricane's a Cannon special,
exactly.
Right? Being able to get the W procs.
You sit on the BF, you get your Hurricane, then you get Infinity Edge, and maybe later you can get something like Blade of the Ruined King if you want that for the late game. But you also will need some sort of defensive item because there is quite a lot of champions here who's going to dive towards the backline of Europe.
Of course, got to respect the potential for the flash engage from Faker. Flash a little bit of ways away, but Isle of Duran up and available. Additionally, the Olaf fearlessly can run in there. A lot of CC, but it's just not going to matter to him.
You have to remember, Illaoi is the kind of champion who wants you to dive the backline.
Oh, yes.
Then you run right through like multiple tentacles, and it's a 2-0 Illaoi. So if Benki's up there now, he might actually die in a 1v2.
I mean, vision control is just insanely strong. If you face check Team Ice, you got the Illaoi, Cannon, Garen will spin to win. Of course, not even talking about the base damages from the Zyra. It's only Galio on the side of Team Fire that you get the same respect from, but regardless, both teams are going to be actively trying to get vision control because the face checks can explode a team in just a matter of seconds.
Of course, the mid lane relatively even in terms of pressure, at least at this stage. Pekka picking up those waves, but Bangi and Madlife are moving into the jungle. Just going to throw down some vision their own, clear out some of the vision that Ice have so diligently set up, and right as the blue buff spawns.
Well, this might actually be bad for LCK because the rest of Europe is moving in. Mithy not hitting the snare. picking out, taking question damage in mid. Blue buff Galio can just keep spamming away, and Baker
getting aggressive here, not afraid to tank up the tower shots.
No, he's pretty tanky already. Garen, obviously he's not the best scaling champion in the game.
Nope.
Need an vintage if you want some sick damage late game.
There is some synergy though. Very good at proccing the Black Cleaver that he's already rushed down. So it looks like he's going to be picking up one as well. So they will be able to do Armor Shred for both the Alawi and the Cannon to do some good damage. Nice rotation from Fire. Garen exits lane and first tower of the game, going to go to LCK.
Big buff to that gold differential, of course. Now evening it out, 5-day maybe it'll kill score, but a 600 gold lead in favor of the LCK. Reckless backing off. He wants to pressure out the tower, but doesn't have the resources to do so.
And it's a little bit tricky for Europe here to actually like make a play on the map because they can double teleport. Faker already used his down the bottom lane to get that kill very early on. And you really want to get this Garen out of the lane here. You want to get him to some of these side lanes where he can get onto like a squishy Ezreal, even a Jayce. But Pekka is just not able to move because the wave is getting pushed by Faker all the time.
I mean, you say you want to get him a side lane. You want to get him a side brush is what you want, actually.
Right.
You want him marshalling a big minion wave, then assassinating someone. It's too greedy to take it.
Goes wide for it. He does have the ultimate. He's just waiting for the silence to time out. Now Bangi's in there. Oh. That's a party in the mid lane. Faker taking down with the Ignite. Wants a little bit more action, but Faker's going to make it out to safety.
And hit level 11 with that ult on two people. Already doing a lot of damage. Poking on Faker, but poke damage will only heal him up, so another all-in to take down the Galio.
And another situation where the animation of the Q from Garen is just too slow, so Faker gets up that shield, stays alive, and Bengi obviously there to make sure they pick up a kill, and Europe putting a lot of focus on that mid lane.
Not something that we talked about early on, didn't expect to see so much focus. Of course, didn't expect to see a Garen either, but Prey now in trouble, but the TP coming
Faker.
In. Faker, of course, no ultimate available. Here does start to move forward, not at all scared to tank this one out. Hash cannot afford to back up into the Zyra ult, but will now free to pull back. Now it looks like LCK going to pressure the bottom side tower.
Really interesting to see if Faker puts some more points into his W. Will make any health stackers unkillable with the 75 armor and magic resistance provides for now. Looks like he's maxing at second, so he's still tanky when he pops the W, but he's not unkillable like he is when he has 5 points. And that runic bulwark.
And you have to go for an awkward build as a Galio, not being able to go for any magic resistance because you're against so many physical damage dealers on the side of Europe here. Top lane is still going lower and lower because Soas is just like hammering away on the tower, and he can kill Smep if he wants to now. Pretty fed Illaoi. Sadly for Europe, they're not able to kind of speed up the game right now.
I mean, I was actually surprised he was able to teleport in the face of an Illaoi with the two AD items so confidently as the squishy Jace, but it worked out so far. He does have the item advantage, as Soaz hasn't been able to shop.
Level advantage, Soaz gonna use the ult here, wants to throw down some damage. Jace pulling back, but pulling into enemy territory will be cursed up. Tentacle's gonna slap, Tentacle's going to spawn, but a tower's dropped, meanwhile, on the bottom side of the map. Bengi is on his way up. Smeb, can he live long enough to get his jungler into the fight? Garen is there as well, but Soaz,
oh,
his eyes on the prize. Smeb with the fancy footwork going to live, at least so far. No ult for Soaz.
Peke is coming, so is Jankos.
Garen moving in. Is he going to get anything?
Gets the minions.
Worth.
That worth it for Peke. He gets the minions on top side. Soaz almost taking down Smeb again up in that top lane, but bot lane tower did go down. LCK 2,000 gold lead now.
And the question is, how much does Garen do if you start losing inner turrets? Even once you lose your outer turrets, suddenly there's a lot less space that you can really guarantee is going to be unchecked. And then suddenly the Schrodinger's bush situation with the Garen becomes more and more predictable.
I mean, how much is Illaoi, Garen, and AD Cannon really going to do when
Wait,
you're
put a
behind?
Number on this one, Martin. Come on, Deficio. How much are they going to do?
Basically nothing, if they fall really far behind. It is still okay for Europe. They have some good first items. They're only 2,000 gold down. This is one team fight, and then it's an ace for Europe, and suddenly, you know, it's a Baron, just predicting what's going to happen in about 5-6 minutes. Bengi is coming top lane again.
Oh, Soaz got caught out on day one. It looks like day three will be a similar story. Pulling back, Test of Spirit does get denied.
There's no ulti, sadly, but Soaz just a few seconds.
Doesn't connect. He's trying to bait him in.
Bing is so afraid all the time, also because Europe is coming again.
Collapse onto the top side a lot. This is the wombo combo potential we talked about in Champion Select.
One Bengi, the
plant. They're
going to
go forward. Bengi, can he hit the plant? Can he make it out? Doesn't look like it. Yes! No! Gets knocked out mid-air. Reckless cutting him down. Fire, falling a little short there. And Peke's already on the bottom side. What is LCK's next move?
A lot of these turrets here are very low now. Faker trying to go for Peke. Realizes he doesn't want to go into the rush against the Garen.
running this one out. Does do a lot of damage here. Has the blue buff. We talked about this before. It's going to be a long, slow
teleport.
Ignite does go down, trying to deny the healing. Baker, who's on the way in. Soaz is here. Bray is here as well. There's not any CC. Want to get more damage, but not enough. Garen ult not going to be there. But Baker caught out. That's a lot. Mithy from over the wall. Looks like Madlife could be next. That's a lot of burst damage right up front. Soaz looking for a little bit more. As you all not going to connect. Madlife trying to make it out. Bray looking for the disengage for his team. But Mithy flies forward. He connects it. Yanko's not going to have the cocoon follow up.
Nice mechanics, but they know they can't continue to follow. Bengi had already respawned. They still get their first turret of the game, the outer in the bot lane. Ocean Drake has spawned, but they don't feel confident enough to start it just yet. And Jace looks like he's going to get the third outer turret. So outer Drake will go down, probably at the cost of this Ocean Drake.
Now the mid lane tower, the tier 1 mid lane tower for LCK is about 50%. Top lane tower is like 5 HP, one hit only. So there will be a lot of gold for Europe to pick up very, very soon if they can actually get to these towers here. I'm sure Source will get the top tower.
I mean, it's only a support Nautilus, so that's enough to dissuade, but we will go back and look at this. Baker overextends. Smeb did not have TP, did it to get back to top lane to complete the push that he'll be doing about a minute ago. And it looks like he was going to get away on just a sliver of HP, but Mithy is in the right spot.
Absolutely makes a hero play here. A beautiful snare ult over the wall. Zyra damage, more than enough to finish it out. And so close to taking down Madlife as well as we close out that replay. And you mentioned the tower differential here. EU potentially take two more towers if they take one of those alongside the double Ocean Drakes and 200 gold lead. But still, advantage to EU. This mid game looking pretty solid so far.
Yeah, equal in gold, but with, you know, just a sliver on mid lane, you can say effectively about 1,000 gold in just a couple of seconds. But if they can't get access to that mid lane, they keep it pushing. It is just a line ball game, which is awesome to see, let's be real.
But again, we have now seen Europe for the last 5 minutes get Garen out of the mid lane and actually start moving around. They're going for Faker.
Oh, stun goes in, silence goes in. He's not going to be able to ult. Will he get it up in time? Yes, that's a massive seal from the Courage of the Colossus, but not enough courage to close this one out. Peke says, die, Baker, die, and makes it look all too
easy. I mean, no one was coming. There's three on the top side of the map. They're going to steal away a red buff, get control over Baron, but no other real objectives to contest, so it's just free kills over to Team Ice.
Europe might try and go for the mid tower, but the rest of LCK is already here, trying to defend.
20 minutes and the gold is dead even. This could be the fight. It shifts it back into the favor of either one of these lineups. Nice backing off, Fire backing off as well. Not picking this fight, instead turning their attention to the top side.
Yeah, Source got that tower with the minions. Did decide to stay around. Tried to go for that 1v2, but...
Yeah, didn't even catch this one, so it was a 1v1 across the map.
Of course, a lot of pressure now on the top side of the map. Smeb continuing to push out despite his early struggles in lane against the Alawi, at least with the support of the Yankos. Not really amounting to too much at this point in the game.
Will still be some very, very explosive minutes now. If we look at like Alawi and Garen, like these bruisers often like a strong early game, but then also like in the mid game on 1 to 2 items, they can take down like so many of these squishy targets so easily and still be fairly tanky at the same time. We haven't hit the late game where they suddenly start falling out, like run out of damage, especially to Garen. Alawi will always have damage.
Well, and of course, speaking of hitting those two item points, Smeb picking up a mortal reminder so early on against an Alawi feels really impactful.
Yeah, I was watching the Kesper Cup, and specifically in the final, as Bengi's gonna face check, but he has a Banshee Veil, he'll be alright. Specifically in the final, against Poppy, his build was very similar. That cleaver into armor penetration was able to beat Poppy, should be good here as Bengi.
Knight goes down, he's going for more. Peke just does not care. Multiple members in front of him. Bengi going to live anyway. Madlife is the one taking all the damage, though. It's absolutely massive in the favor of Team Ice, but now they have to run. There's too many low health bars, and Peke is a man possessed as he leaps in time and time again.
It's not the top Nautilus that can just teleport and impact fights. It is the Jace. So even though he has teleport, very much a defensive teleport user, it's going to stay push up bot and another free kill over to Ice.
It's what we talked about with these bruisers. Again, they have damage here in the mid game. They're tanky enough to like be super aggressive. And Peke just showed that once again. Another easy pickup here. Yanga's been able to land some very easy cocoons because targets are CC to knocked up. And he picks up his second kill. So very, very even game so far.
You're just finishing off the point on the double armor penetration rush from the Jace. If it's enough to take down Poppy, theoretically it should be enough to take down Soaz. And given we were kind of pigeonholed into thinking Poppy beats Jace after about 2 armor items, very interesting to keep tracking that even in this matchup.
I think you can criticize getting the Last Whisper as a second item. I think if you want the healing reduction, you get the Excusenus Calling, and then you complete another item, and then as a third item, you get the Last Whisper. Because if you look at Europe and the itemization, there isn't that much armor you're really going to penetrate, because it's only bonus armor you're going for. It's literally just a little bit on source, and that's the only thing. So it's not the most effective item now, but obviously he's expecting very soon to see more armor on the side of Europe, and then he knows, okay, I need to have that item ready for that potential big fight.
And probably does have those bonus scalings as well. Bengi wants to track Soaz once again.
Ghosting in, we've seen this before. Soaz, can he turn into the healing reduction? Is absolutely massive in this exchange. Does get knocked out. Smep potentially in trouble, but Bengi is going to pick that one up quite easily.
Smep seems to be figuring out the Illaoi slowly, slowly. Again, would have only had limited practice even in solo queue against this pick. So a couple of kills, a bit of confidence boost to the side of Fire as Becky and Faker are still having at it, this time in the top.
Not going to be a whole lot of damage traded back and forth, though. Of course, Garen usually going to heal it up. Galio, pretty quick to deny that damage, especially with the now completed Zhonya's Hourglass. As we check in on the bottom lane, see Prey pretty content at that two-item spike. And Reckless, you talked about it. This is the 80 carry itemization across the board, Infinity Edge and the Rune Ants.
This tells you how strong this pair of items is, that even on a champion like Cannon without the same steroids as other attack damage carries, it's still Infinity Edge, Hurricane as the staple. Ultimate's very much going to be purely for disengage. Won't see this cannon diving in like an AP cannon, but we'll be able to peel away someone diving. Unless, of course, the Ragnarok is popped by Ben.
Meanwhile, Snap's going to take down that tower uncontested. Ice not willing to give up the resources to stop him, and now he's going to get a blue buff as well.
And now with obviously Soaz completing that Randuin completely, and Smep just focusing purely on the 1v1, the Last Whisper is going to do a lot of good for him against Soaz. Won't really do anything against the other four members, but I don't think he cares because they keep just ganking Soaz and taking down fast enough.
And also they're ganking Faker as well. Moving forward, Yankless does land Cocoon. I don't know if they have enough damage, but that's a lot coming in from xPeke. It's safely under the tower. TP coming in now. They look like they may extend the fight. Will be fully completed. Now, Smep moving forward, is going to throw down a bit more damage. Bengi's on the backside. He's already ulted, though, and it may be a little bit too early. Smep's taken down xPeke. The damage from Jace, a little bit too much. Now they're going to have to run for their life. Flash of the wall from Yankos. He's in trouble. Soaz is finally in the fight. Is he going to get the ult down? Yes, only hits one, though. Maybe looking for a little bit more. No test of spirit quite yet. Depth charge goes in, and down goes Yankos. Soaz has to fight now like a man possessed. The healing reduction will come in. That's a lot going over the wall. Soaz wants a little more. Can he get Prey? Not going to get it. Mithy on the way in. Fire absolutely cleaning house here, and Ice just getting crushed.
Yeah, the predicted big teamfight win for Europe that was going to happen within 5 minutes actually went in favor of LCK, and I feel like we've seen that before. It's a good start from the other team. It's fairly early mid-game. And then big fight, LCK punishes, and now they're taking Baron.
Looking Reckless still has a lot of damage here, so they have to be careful.
And poking into the fight, they're going to try to CC him, but Nautilus going to hook the wall instead. Falling a little bit lower, ever closer to that spine point. They are going to get it in the end. Reckless not going to even get the 1v1. Smeb making it out. Dangerous game, just a bit too much. Taking it to safety with a sliver of his life, and that's going to be Baron secured for the LCK and Team Fire.
We're going to finally get the replay here. So Peke have gone very aggressively onto Faker. Eats the slow, turns in, and with the double armor penetration, it's going to go down just complete to the Jace, and then it's just really scattered. Reckless has to use his ult, runs away himself, fighting on two flanks. Madlife flashes in just to look for an auto attack to attract targets, and even though these are fed bruisers, they're not fighting as five, they're fighting as
exactly.
One, B2, B3, and eventually come tumbling down.
Yeah, Soaz has to teleport in like behind the rest of his team, only got ult in one member, really didn't get to use any of the team fighting presence Illaoi can have, even though she's obviously much better when it comes to like the early laning phase. Still strong at this point if you get that 3-4 man ulti. Same can be said for Cannon, for Zyra. Like, it's a lot of AoE on the side of Europe, but when you split up, well, AoE suddenly is very hard to use.
We talk a lot about Europe needing to group up, looking for that sort of wombo team fight where they can land everything in succession. However, what is now the path for Fire, other than picking up a kill on Mithy?
Good start.
He might be able to do. Ooh, nice flash out in the end. Sidestep on the axe. Mithy making some fancy footwork. The chilling smite. Gonna cut his dreams down. And Bengi just gonna pick up a little redemption.
Pops the flare as well. Suddenly playing with the confidence that we didn't see in the early game. They're looking to get on Faker.
Faker moving forward. Decent damage coming in from the Illaoi, but Soaz taking so much back in return. That's Spear not gonna get proc quite yet. Now, gonna be cursed up. Decent damage. The team is on the way. We could be looking at a full fight. Faker going to drop. That's a good start to it, but Peke's getting taken down on the backside. Madlife, Prey, Bengi moving forward. Yankos not quite sure where he wants to go. Will to start to back off. Bengi, no ultimate available to pursue, and Reckless waiting over the other side of a wall.
The gold lead now is really starting to shine through. It wasn't one for the majority of the game, but 7,000, especially with that Baron take. The items are starting to be loaded up, and it's Talisman of Ascension from the jungle from Bengi. Didn't want to go for the selfish speed up of Righteous Glory. It's now the team wide speed up with the Talisman.
Tower is going to fall reckless. Doing his best to clear out the waves, but it's simply not enough. Papasmithy, you're absolutely right. It's just looking harder and harder. Seems like a pretty clean closeout from Team Fire if they play right. I mean, is it still looking for opportunities here for Team Ice?
We talked about it. When the inner turrets go down, it has to be just super hard engage in vision as melee bruises, and that so rarely works at the highest level.
Exactly. It's really, really hard for Europe to like start a team fight by hard engaging. They need to like flank around.
He's getting picked off. Bangy just going to use the Ragnarok to make his way out. It's a decent amount of damage. Procs going down on the Mark of the Storm, but not enough. Gets stunned up here. Cocoon does connect on the right, but only four members left, so has a lot of power on the allow. He does hit two with Technical Slam. Peking going in. Does get burned down instantly. The Jace damage too much. So has, though. Ults up. Tet's Spirit goes down. Madlight going to be set to fall. They're trading back and forth here.
But the thing you need to take away, and the thing we're kind of hitting hard on, is if these champions stand 5v5 in the lane, ARAM style, Ice don't have a fight starter. That's not reckless. It's AD Cannon is about being in disengage. There is a lot of initiation from Fire, and unfortunately for Ice, unless they fight a fight on the terms of LCK that they misjudge, they're not going to get the fight they're looking for.
Well, sadly for Europe, the way back might be hoping LCK makes a mistake around an objective, and they have multiple lanes, but I feel like we've said that before, and it almost just never happened when you're playing the Korean squad here, and it is difficult. It's been a very fun game to watch, though, with so many different fights and these different picks. Mithia, sadly for him, tries to be the guy engaging, and does go down, and let's see here. Fight around the blue buff.
Yanko takes a lot of damage. Baker maybe looks for that one. Flash in, Idol of Durant. Yanko's going to get dropped there. Sven more than happy to take the blue buff. Deficio, you mean you brought up Mithy? So happy to be the playmaker in that early stage of the game, but now no longer is it just base levels and base items. Everyone getting more and more, and Mithy, of course, no tanky stats. Really keeping the line.
And that's the case, late game is so, so strong as well. Like, Faker not really getting one shot anymore. Ezreal has these items to deal with bruises.
So Ez has to be careful. Picked up here.
Whoa!
Hits a couple people. xPeke trying to disengage on Bangi. A lot of damage as Tet's Spirit goes down. Bangi gonna make it out. The tower has already fallen, but a lot of members cursed up on the side of Team Fire. So as too low to continue, and Fire just gonna grab this inhibitor. A little brawl there, but no one going to drop other than Yanko.
So many speed ups as well. Acceleration Gate, the Righteous Gust from the Galio. Able to get away very quickly after picking up the objective, and suddenly not many camps on the map to pick up, not many minions pushing in. This is very much the Korean standard when it comes to the late game, where there's not many resources for EU, and if they make it engage at 10,000 gold behind, even though their champions do well in melee range, not going to be fought on their turn.
Bangi now running out. Not a whole ton of damage here, but this one starts to move forward. This mount, will Bangi start to turn, throws the axe back to try to disengage. Ghost has been popped. May just be the pick here for Yanko's hand, but there's people on the way. I don't know if he's going to be able to grab it, just looking for the Venomous Bite to close out. Will not need it.
Best
of Spirit. He's trapped, though. He's all alone. Flashes up the wall. Death Charge still going to connect. It's going to hit two as well. Soez has to back off. He's damage coming from the backside from Prey. Ice now retreating in the top lane. Garen split pushing, meanwhile, on the bottom side. xPeke. Brought out the Garen. Now
the double teleport.
Something wrong about double teleport being against an EU team, against a xPeke team.
Really well played by LCK with the teleports all game long, honestly. Bad Life might go down.
Reckless, keep your eyes on the cannon. Does have the ultimate available, and Yanko's fearless on the front line, but he may get popped. Smeb is locked up. Tentacle Smash goes down. Not going to connect. Redemption going in, looking for the heal, but who is it? Going to be the side of Team Fire. Soaz now gets the Test of Spirit. Mad Life could be in trouble. Soaz staying near the tower to tank it out, but shut down onto Smeb. He gets caught out. And xPeke is still alive on the bottom side.
Yeah, he's one versus two here. Faker going for him. Gets the slow.
Really fast. Starting to spin. TP coming in. Can they burn him down? Nice footwork to move it out. Galio skill shots very slow. Soaz is here. He wants to start a party. The tentacles are coming down. Will they be able to cut through him? Test of Spirit. Prey now cursed, but he doesn't have any way to chase these guys down.
Prey's one of the best at going in and out of fights. He's not going to allow Soaz to escape, but there's another
Spirit. That could be massive. Can he do anything? No. Prey walking out unscathed.
And the W also gives him the bonus resist, so more than happy to once again go into close range. Still fights across the map, but all in the context of Korea being pretty significantly ahead.
Wait, Becker, you want to see if we can take the red buff? And then obviously take the cone out. A little bit having fun here.
That was pretty good.
I mean, never question Becker when it comes to split pushing and escaping.
And that's a preview, of course, of the some of the mechanics in the jungle, the plants that we'll see in the future season, of course. At this point, still trying to extend really any way to get out.
And all of your pre-call instead of taking that free tower because they're trying to make it all the way down to the bottom lane. See if they can join. You can see Reckless need the pace as well, but also actually had super minions at the next turret they had to go back and deal with. So fair enough, take that one back. Europe had to go back and defend the turret. You can see the one Nexus turret on your minimap is very, very low.
Of course, Prey clearing out the minion wave as best he can because it is now Baron time. You laying down a bit of vision to try to secure the area. Mad like maybe oversetting here, but the snare not gonna connect. Backing off, Fire just moved right in, and Europe not comfortable enough to take this fight without knowing where everyone is.
And Bengi, another support item. He knows exactly his place, guys. He's always been
I mean, this is his job application. Yeah, I'm a supportive jungler, please.
I mean, there's 3 years of, like, proof, 4 years perhaps, to show that. But once again, the Knights of Vow also, I don't actually see who he's linked to. It would be kind of lore appropriate if it was Faker.
Could definitely be Faker.
I mean, that's who you put
might
your
be the Ezreal
on.
Or the Jace.
It is the Ezreal.
Ooh, I mean, it should be Faker.
Obviously, AD carry. With the extra damage he can deal for some more HP coming towards you as an Olaf.
I mean, Faker's the king. Bengi's definitely the knight, so that's why I thought he might go for it.
Bengi's the princess.
Princess, huh?
Yeah, he's the princess.
I don't know what led you to that conclusion, and I don't want to know.
I thought Flame was the princess.
Yeah, that's actually true. There can be more.
A lot of royalty in League of Legends. A lot of royalty here, of course, on the stage as well. xPeke busting out the Garen this game. It started so well, but it's kind of been going downhill, just not having quite enough damage here in these fights. And so as Glowy looks terrifying, but
yeah.
The ultimate counter, of course, people just going to walk away.
Again, it is sadly some of the things we mentioned, you know, these bruisers being so good in the mid game on 1 to 2 items. But then later on, the other team starts getting a bit of armor. It gets really, really difficult then to kind of burn through all of it and take down these fights. Unless you get that big 5-on-5 team fight where all your AoE works, but LCK is not going to give you that fight.
May not find the opportunity. Prey, though, we'll find the opportunity to take the blue buff here. Baron remains. The big objective on the map is you holding on to dear life at this point. An 8k gold differential 35 minutes in. It's 2 dragons to 2. The Mountain Drake for LCK makes that Baron all the more threatening, as well as the insane amount of AD threats between the Jace and the Ezreal.
And when you move away from the mid game, you know, once you get a couple of items for Prey, he's Ezreal. He's slippery already. He's got the Blade of the Ruin King now. He's always been a counterpick to picks like Aurelia in the top lane just because he is that mobile AD carry. So just closing the distance on Prey and killing him instantly, hard to do.
So as caught out once again, healing's reduced, and that means he's going to get popped instantly. Too much damage, not enough armor. Lord Dominix as well as the Mortal Reminder, he's not going to find anything there. Now Mithy, the one in trouble, does look for the ult to disengage, but may get caught out, does sidestep in the end. Shock Blast going to take him. Baker looking for the 2v1 in the meantime, but Peke going to grab another kill. Redemption comes down. Not gonna save anyone as Prey goes on a rampage.
I say worth for Europe. They killed Faker. That... You're gonna
take
lose your next anyway. Might as well take down Faker another time.
Commanding early game coming in for Europe in a few close, scrappy duels. But once Fire finds the lead, once we get out of that mid game, it is LCK who've been able to find it, close it out with confidence. Reckless with one last desperate play, but Yankos gets popped. Reckless is next on the menu. Not even gonna make it into the spawn as the ace comes out from the LCK. Team Fire looking to pick up 100 points here. And Korea reminding us why they are on top of the world. An all-star lineup crushing through each and every other region.
Yep, 3-0.
Not like we ever forgot it. Oh. I mean, I don't think there was anyone.
I forgot for about 30 seconds when xPeke got that Garen double kill.
Very true. We had a brief moment where we were like, oh, this is it. Just like last year where Europe took them down. Nope. LCK, 300 points obviously picked up by these guys in these regional clashes.
Yeah, picking up the slack of some of the struggles that Team Fire actually has had in the fun modes. And the fun modes have gone pretty much over Team Ice, and they're in a really good spot also.
Okay.
When the
shorts.
One-on-ones. The shorts being repped.
High shorts. Feels appropriate. The bruisers were played in that game.
Funny story, all players from the EU team got these shorts here, except for Mithy. And I'm actually not sure why. He was the only one who didn't get them.
There's an interview question.
Yeah.
Ash later.
I really don't know why.
Mithy, why didn't you get the shorts? Well, he's distinctly warmer than the rest of the members of Mice.
There you see. There you go. Black Pants and Mithy.
But at the end of the day, of course, an exciting match to watch. So much fun with all these unique picks.
Oh, yes.
A little less fun when you have to watch the Galio tank turret shots for about 30 seconds there without taking
Ooh, the pants cam.
Look at him, Lex.
Oh, looking fresh. Team coming out on stage, as promised.
This is the catwalk, guys.
The Dang. Crowd going absolutely nuts.
Mithy really wish he had the shorts.
It's one thing to be the only guy in the shorts. It's another thing to be the only guy without the shorts.
Yeah, Yankos will shave his legs as well. Anyway, apart from that, LCK taking down Europe. I think a lot of people expected it. Crowd is still cheering for xPeke and Europe.
I mean, home turf still had a really exciting game. A couple of hype early game plays as well. I mean, you got to give props to Team Ice. They're like, this is going to be a hard battle. We're going to try something new see what happens.
I thought we'd get more of this at All-Stars, honestly. I thought we'd get more of the kind of fun picks, you know, going for interesting things with Korean players. Actually on the crowd now, doing about just as popular as their European counterparts. Always great to see.
Of course, all-star talent across the board. Faker, Smeb, Bangi, Prey, Madlife as well.
All-star casting talent? I mean, by definition, we are at all-star.
We are actually here.
No need to toot any horns.
That's true.
I'll take it. I'll take the opportunity. I need it. I'm not going to.
Pick me up for today.
All right. Look good. But of course, looking ahead in the day, Team Fire now taking the lead. Pretty important for them to get this one going.
Especially because Team Ice has 9 players left in the 1v1 tournament. Team Fire has 7. 4 of the LPL players obviously left, actually looking very good in the 1v1.
And so 4 of the players from the GPL as well,
on
the side of Fire.
On the other side, but I think Team Ice there can pick up quite some points. So yes, Team Fire needed this one. More game modes later today. The one for all is 50 points, of course. That can matter a lot in the end, because coming into today, they were dead even in points, both Team Fire and Team Ice. And while the players, of course, are here to have fun, and they say that, they always add in, but we also kind of want to win.
It's pretty fun to win, Deficio.
Of course, Reckless, especially a guy who's like, oh,
in the 1v1,
he's like, look, I'm playing Canada, we're gonna give the people what they want here, but in 1v1s, I'm all about the W. I am all about finding that win. Of course, getting a chance, of course, for the interview to set up on stage. But in the meantime, I mean, defining moment so far for All-Stars as both EU and LCK play their last full 5v5.
I mean, Garen getting locked in.
I was about to say.
That's a defining moment for any tournament.
Kill as well.
You know, the Garen fans out there, the Garen one tricks in solo queue, wait for so long to see their main on the big stage. They probably don't watch LPL, let's be real, but they get it at All-Star. So that's pretty cool.
Just reminds me of that gif of Amazing Jay playing Garen.
Yeah.
Spinning in real life. Not doing it.
Disappointed we didn't see it at Worlds from Amazing Jay. Maybe next time he's there. Defining moment as well, 1v1 tournament. I think the Yasuo versus Yasuo Faker was fantastic. Also watching Ziv versus Smeb, where Ziv is like winning the matchup and then he walks into tower and takes 2 shots. You're just kind of like, what? This is like one of the best top lanes in the world? What was that?
I think at this point between the Garen, all we can do is hope for more highlight moments here at All-Star. But in the meantime, we're going to throw it down to Dash, who's on stage with the L.